Ever wondered how the world's loudest bird sounds? Oh yes, that is real, like some kind of fire alarm. As many birds, this male uses his voice to woo his dream girl. Almost half of all bird species are grouped together simply because they're so good at singing. The songbirds. And this guy is one of them. But why do birds even sing? And can all songbirds produce their beautiful songs right from the start, or do they need a vocal coach? Open your ears and listen to find out. This feathery friend with that weird appendage on its beak is the loudest bird on Earth. Have a listen. This bird is a white bellbird home to the rainforests of Brazil, and is about the size of a pigeon. But for its small stature, its voice really packs a punch. The call is about 125 decibels loud. That's noise at the level of a rock concert. For reference, noises start to become hazardous for the human ear at around 85 decibels. But why does this bird have to be that ear-shatteringly loud? Well, this bird is a male, so he needs his voice to be heard by the ladies of his species. And you can let us hear your voice as well. Tell us what you liked about this video in the comments. For more AI-free nature content like this, hit that subscribe button. Thanks a lot, and now on with the show. The white bellbird is not only the loudest bird in the world, but also the loudest songbird. Songbirds are the largest group of birds on our planet and make up almost half of all bird species worldwide. But aren't birds in general known to sing? Well, there are a lot of birds that can make calls, but are not songbirds. Ostriches. Not a song. Eagles. Nope. Parrots. They are more the talkative type than singers. Chickens. Well, that's a no, but is it that obvious? So what qualifies a bird as a songbird? Well, it really has to do with how humans sort birds. And there are about 4,000 different bird species considered songbirds. Blackbirds, robins, tits, the banana quit, and weaver birds. But also ravens and other corvids. The term songbird can be a behavioral descriptor and can also be a taxonomic identifier. This can lead to some confusion, where a bird is genetically a songbird but doesn't actually sing. Ravens, though technically songbirds, don't sing. They rather use calls. Now, calls and songs are not the same. Calls are shorter and simpler sounds, often used by birds to warn of danger or just to notify other birds of their presence. Most often, calls are not something that a bird needs to learn. Instead, they can just do that instinctively. Songs tend to be longer and more complex than calls, as they convey more information, like where the singer's territory is, or how good of a partner the bird might be. Songbirds are not only a large group, but also widespread. Apart from Antarctica, songbirds can be found on every continent, and they come in lots of different shapes and sizes, from tiny sparrows to smart crows. This group is really diverse. And what connects all songbirds is the syrinx, also known as the songbox, the organ they use to produce their sounds. Almost all birds have a syrinx, but a songbird syrinx is more complex. They have more musculature around the songbox to control their singing with higher precision. Some songbirds can control these muscles independently and create two sounds at the same time. The whole process is quite similar to how humans produce speech, but instead of a syrinx, humans have a larynx. Our vocal cords, contained in the larynx, vibrate to create sound. And birds do essentially the same, but the syrinx creates the vibration without needing the vocal cords. These white bellbird songs are used to attract females. They seem to go for the loudest singer. In addition, the males will also perform a short shuffle dance that involves the male shouting right into the female's face. A lot of male songbirds sing to appeal to the ladies in their vicinity, but some prefer to put on a show to make themselves more enticing. This orange bird is called a cock of the rock. They are also native to South America and are relatives to the white bellbird. But this species does not rely on volume to determine who is best. The fancy orange males meet at a lek, a display arena, where they squabble amongst each other. They try to scare the others away with attacks and calls. Once a female arrives, conspicuous in her brown color, they stop fighting and start displaying their orange plumage. Some males try to interrupt the show of their adversaries by barging in and calling out. But in the end, it is up to the female to decide who is her favorite. The sounds that this bird makes here are referred to as calls, not songs. It's not that the cock of the rock cannot sing, but for this purpose, a call will suffice. A remarkable example of courtship songs is what scientists call the dawn chorus. This refers to the time of day, right around dawn in spring, when all the songbirds start to sing. Birds also tend to sing louder during the dawn chorus. Males will often start before sunrise to train their songs, warming up their syrinx for the early morning concert. But saying that only male birds sing would be a wrong assumption. Females sing more often than previously thought. Mostly for the same reasons as males do: territory, mate attraction, and enhancing pair bonds. Female barn swallows seem to sing before they begin breeding. Different species also have rather exact times when they will start to sing in the morning. That's why bird clocks are a thing. And there seems to be a reason why birds sing their songs that early in the morning. Songbirds of both sexes want to set themselves apart from their competitors, and no bird sounds alike. So, the key to presenting themselves favorably to other members of their species is to have a clear song. And the songs can be heard most clearly in the morning. The reason for this is the warmth of the sun, or rather the lack of it. When the sun rises, it heats the ground and the air. The warm air rises and mixes with colder air, creating atmospheric turbulence. And the later it gets in the day, the more turbulence builds up in the air. With turbulence in the air, the bird songs become distorted and can't be heard as clearly or travel as far. So, to sound as good as possible, birds sing in the wee hours of the morning. They also sing louder as a whole because every bird around is chiming in and searching for a partner. And so they need to try and be as loud as possible to not be overheard among all the other songs. Singing a song during the dawn chorus, but also at other times of the day, serves not only as an attraction device, but also as a deterrent to rivals. Male birds secure their territories with it and tell their neighbors, "Hey, I'm still here, stay away." By doing that, they show everyone that they made it through the darkness of the night and survived to sing another day. And what is really amazing is the fact that bird songs need to be learned. And the learning process is similar to how human children learn to speak. That's why researchers use it as a model to study how vocal learning works. Baby birds learn songs in two phases. The first one is the sensory learning phase. It begins when the chicks are around 1 to 3 months old. In this phase, the young birds will memorize one or more tutor songs. For example, the father's territory song. In this phase, learning can be really quick. Only a few minutes can be enough for the juvenile bird to produce a good copy of a tutor song. Chicks can also copy various other sounds like car alarms or chainsaws, but prefer to learn the songs of their species. A chick that grows up without hearing any tutor songs, for example when in captivity, will still be able to sing. But it will sing a simple, isolate song, which seems to be too simplistic to attract potential mates. In the wild, young birds pick up a variety of songs from those around them. Through copy errors, improvisation, or innovation, they often add their own twist, creating something new and uniquely theirs. Because of these circumstantial differences, individual birds of the same breeding population can sound very distinct. Days, weeks, or even months later starts the second learning phase, the sensory motor phase. This time, learning takes much longer. A pupil bird can sing a song from its tutor tens of thousands of times until it achieves an accurate copy. Interestingly, the copying process can work from memory alone, but a juvenile bird must be able to hear itself sing. If a bird is deafened, it ends up learning a heavily distorted song that sounds very different from the tutor's version. The closer a juvenile gets to sexual maturity, the clearer and more consistent its song becomes, with less and less variation. The process of song learning and singing are really complex and rely on neuronal pathways in the brain. All vocalization depends on the precise coordination of muscles, whether learned or innate. And interestingly, the brainstem circuits that control these muscles are remarkably similar in birds and humans. That's why studying bird vocalization might shed some light on human speech. What is scientifically proven is that birdsong is good for your mental health. Going out into nature is already healthy. It reduces stress, heart rate, and blood pressure. But hearing birds sing calms us even more and reduces feelings of depression. Scientists believe it's linked to safety signals in nature. Birds tend to sing when predators aren't around. So, we've learned to associate birdsong with a calm, danger-free environment. That's why it helps us relax. And it seems the bigger the choir and the higher the variety of birdsong, the better. Essentially, the act of singing is a way for birds to measure how fit the others are. Who might be the best partners to raise offspring with? And who can secure the best territory? But it is also so much more. Do you have a favorite bird or bird song? Tell us in the comments. And after you listen to some birds, go check out some more videos. And also, please like, share, and subscribe. Until next time.